Halo.
Halo, Mat. Dengeran ya?
Iya.
Yes.
Oke.
Coba share screen ya, Mat. Udah tinggal berapa menit lagi? Satu menit
Sudah.
lagi.
Ya, we have several. Ya, sudah ada berapa orang ya? Oke. Saya coba share screen. Bisa kelihatan screen?
Bisa. Bisa.
Oke.
Coba gue share ya, Mat, ya. Bisa kelihatan ya, Mat, ya.
Good.
Terus ini.
Good. Kelihatan.
Terus ini.
Udah, kelihatan semua.
Ini kelihatan juga ya. Oke.
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 Oke, dan. Let me change. Yeah, we have some. Okay, it's already 10:21. Let me start the sessions. Thank you for joining the sessions. Let me share the my screen. Ah, okay. Okay. Yeah. Let me start. Thank you for joining the workshop sessions in API Days Jakarta 2020. So in this session, we are going to share on what skills are required in this API economy. We call it hybrid skills and how it relate with DevOps. I would like to take us back where we all in the past. I believe we all been there. If we put our service in the sky, just like this, it would like this, it was this simple. This was our solution to answer the business problem. This one bright little star. Even it's not tiny enough, but it's give us simplicity and of course pain at the same time. And suddenly with all this technology and architecture evolution, starting from the service oriented architecture, micro front end, microservices or other architectural style, we can solve much business problem with much performance and flexibility. But suddenly we are ended up in a space like this, right? We ended up in this beautiful architectural approach, where all services become atomic. It increased our capability, of course, in how to scale the services, achieving what we are dreaming of, the loosely coupled services. But on the other side, we have to deal with this complexity. We have to think on how to maintain all the services in terms of speed, the delivery of the quality, and the quality, the security, not to mention the reliability of the service. And then the compliance and regulatory standard we have to follow in the enterprise. And then we have to ensure we can have the mechanism and then we can bring it as the model in our organizations. So in the sessions, in the workshop session, we will share how it should work in your organizations and then how to upskill your people. So what skills are required? And then combine it and then what we call the hybrid skills. And then it of course can bring significant benefit to your enterprise in this API economy. Let me introduce myself. My name is Made Mulia Indrajaya. I'm a DevOps accredited trainer from DevOps Institute. I'm also a consultant and coach. Currently, I'm a managing partner of Narada Code and ambassador of DevOps Institute. I'm also an organizer of DevOps Days Jakarta and also DevOps Indonesia community, a community based in Indonesia with more than 3,000 members. If you haven't joined the community, you can go to devopindonesia.org and be part of this modern movement. Today, I have my colleague, Thomas Impantoro, a DevOps professional, automation engineer and architect in Narada Code. You can say hi to Thomas.
Hi, everyone.
He has been in this modern engineering and architectural space for almost 20 years. So we have the presentation and then some exercise and also the demo in these sessions. We're also representing DevOps Institute in these sessions. So DevOps Institute, as you know, is a continuous learning community, work to advance the human element of DevOps by creating a safe interactive environment where then as a member we can network, gain knowledge, grow our career, and support the enterprise transformations. If you're not part of the DevOps Institute community, you can join. You can access to devopsinstitute.com. A lot of knowledge and resources there that will of course help you in this, in your transformation journey. And Radacode, we are one of the accredited training organizations of DevOps Institute in Indonesia. We are helping enterprises to accelerate their digital journey by providing education, assessment, and then guiding their implementations with all this modern enterprise IT approach, such as DevOps, Agile, Lean, and IT service management. We have extensive experience in various industries, starting from financial, banking, technology, government, to oil and gas industry. Let's continue to our topic on the hybrid skills in the API economy. I would like to take back us and show the landscape and the evolution of our architectural approach. The evolution from monolith to more modular services with service-oriented architecture to more atomic services now, right now. As more services, of course, that are loosely coupled, right? We call it microservices, sometimes call it others. In this loosely coupled, we can think of a group of step function in the same business domain that serve a bigger purpose. Maybe we can group it based on our business domain, such as order, catalog, payment, and other domain, depends on your business model. Of course, this evolution happened because of the demand, faster delivery, lower risk, and more agility. But the architectural evolution also demands the evolution of our operating model and technology stack in the enterprise. Right? These are the evolution of how the operating model looks like nowadays. We shifted from the silo and separated scheme to more dedicated and cross-functional team with focus on specific business domain and the capability. This brings us significant result in the term of speed and agility because of domain specialization and expertise. And of course, the cohesion between members in the team that usually we call squad or whatever the cool names we like, right? This is what it looks like. The landscape is changing from the architectural and also the operating model. And the evolution, the force of this operating model is natural. If we revert to Conway's law, define the structure of software will mirror the structure of the organization that built it. Or easily, if we inverse the Conway law, we have to design our team as the architecture we want to. But behind this architectural style and this operating model, as we grow along the time, it introduces, of course, the challenges. We have to ensure that each team can independently handle their service properly, comply with our regulatory and controls and the standard. They need to be equipped with the proper skills. Start from functional, the technical, and of course the human skills, right? And then not to mention their cognitive load in keep learning and chasing this technology evolution while serving the business needs. This is the challenges. And this, the consequences of this evolution is the complexity. The complexity to achieve the quality standard in our team, in our enterprise. Complexity in the delivery cycle itself. Start from the how to manage the source code, the versioning, the testing in the fast delivery cycle, release management, and even post-delivery process such as monitoring and then observability of the API. The complexity also happened in the API management platform itself. I believe organizations use the API management platform, of course, whether you are using your sophisticated and modern products such as Mole, such as Xway or other platform as well. And then the question is the same, how to maintain the delivery cycle in the speed while maintaining the quality of the delivery, right? How, and then how to enforce any regulatory and compliance requirement. And again, the demand will always the same or even increasing. More quality delivery, faster and reliable. This is the consequences, right? And then this picture show perfectly how our condition looks like in the enterprise with all this complexity, right? We are all sophisticated and looks cool in IT, dealing with all this modern technology stack, but we have a half-life in the enterprise. Start from our day-to-day process of development and then operation process itself. And then we have to find a better way to cope with this challenge. And then the question, what are exactly required in our enterprise? And what are exactly the skills are required to our people and team? I will highlight the most important skills in the team, the CICD one, the CICD skill, right? So this is the one skill that is very, very fundamental to our team in this modern architectural space. So if we want to achieve the capability of the continuous delivery, right, you can release anytime, right? We have to start with all the practices. Start from how we manage our source code management, the branching using the trunk-based development, the feature flag to make our life easier when dealing with the unfinished code so we can integrate, right, frequently. So we can just easily open and close our feature and also the unfinished code. And then get early feedback with the continuous integrations. So we have continuous testing also as part of the element on how we can ensure the quality in our fast delivery cycle, executing automated tests in our deployment pipeline. So the delivery process should leverage pipeline, consists of the tooling that support all the these technical practices. And then all are performed consistently and automated to ensure the governance. And then this is what we call the automated governance. Some elements here are not mandatory. You can also have some more elements. We can see here in the blue color, it is recommended, such as deployment strategy, whether you want to use the canary deployment, rolling, or blue-green, and the pipeline monitoring and the use of container technology, right? All these elements becomes the practices that we should perform in the team as part of the daily routine, enabled by the deployment pipeline. So the deployment pipeline and technology helps us with the consistency of the team and also to apply the governance that we want, right? Okay. Now, so let's focus on the testing. If I go back to the slide, we can see here, there is a box at the continuous testing, right? The continuous testing here. And then when we focus on the testing, what tests should we perform in our delivery? We have a lot of quality assessment. Testing is a quality assessment, right? In our fast delivery cycles, we have to ensure all the quality are there. The team build the quality in from the start, right? So we have, of course, we have a lot of testing here that we want to automate, and sometimes we can we have to perform it manually. We have no choice, right? And then what should we do? What should we perform in our delivery? Right. Since this is a workshop sessions, I would like to invite you guys all to part of this session. So I will share the link. I'm using the Miro, the interactive live canvas here, right? I share it in the chat, Miro. You can join, you can click on the link, and then simply by joining, the click on the link, and then you can join, you can, like this one, I see one person also has joined the interactive live canvas. And then we have, if you see my screen here, I'm still sharing my screen. We have a lot of test activity in the pipeline, right? In the pipeline. So there are some boxes here below colored in the orange or red mix of that. It's the manual activity, manual test activity. And also the green one is the automated test activity. Right, so please put this test activity just like this one, the pre-flight test. If you think this is, if you perform it automatically in the development or in the sprint, you can drag it here, put it here. So you can also add more test activity, right? If you are the first timer of the using Miro, if you join if you click on the link and then open the Miro interactive live canvas, you have to go to the left hand side and click on this one, right? Click this one, change your cursor just like the arrow, and then you can drag and then perform any activity in the canvas. Okay, feel free. Let's take this exercise for maybe 7 minutes. I will start. You can just put all the quality assessment or the test activity in the process. Feel free, right? You can just, I will just put it here. I'm starting, like say in the development, I will perform the code quality scan automatically, right? If you think you have another test activity or in your current process, you can also add it. You can just copy, and you can just copy and then edit the text here and put in our process, in our delivery process. Okay, we still have 6 minutes. If someone has put the test activity, let's say the development, and you feel it's incorrect, you can just drag to another process, or you can just copy it, right? So feel free. So to achieve the CI/CD capability while we are waiting, of course, you can still continue on this activity. So if you want to achieve the CI, the continuous delivery capability, and then the continuous testing is one of the critical the critical capability that we want to have and want to perform in consistently, right? Okay, so no one picked the dynamic application security testing, right? Okay, so finally, okay, in just 3 minutes, we are finished with this exercise, the test activity in pipeline. So do you think we are finished? Okay then. Let's discuss the result of this. Let me stop the timer and then let's see what we have. So we have the test activity in the pipeline here. Thank you for for this exercise, participating in this exercise, the text activity in the pipeline. So let's see, let's review, right? So we have in the requirement, we have the prototyping, the test prioritization, the test plan development, yes. So there is no right or wrong in here, because some organizations, they have different processes, but for sure some of these activities we will then discuss. Like the design, we have story and acceptance test, the usability test. Yes, of course, you can do the usability test upfront, and then also you can do after before you release. It depends, right? But usually you do it in front, right, to test the user experience. The user experience, you can just use the hallway test, and then just ask whoever pass, right, in the hall to test your experience, the user experience of your applications. And then we have software composition analysis in design. No, I think it should be in here in development, right? So software composition analysis is the security test, part of the security test that scan your library or your component, right? So to check if there is a vulnerability in your application. So software composition analysis should be part of your daily process in your team. So while they are developing and then write authoring source code, they have to push into the repository and then perform the software composition analysis. It will perform automatically. The code quality scan, of course, in the development. The peer or code review, yes. We can use the pull request mechanism, right? It depends on the tool. Sometimes they call it merge request also. The automate test script development, yes, you develop it in the sprint, yes. After you test it manually and it works, and then you want to prioritize based on your plan, and then you convert it to automate it, right? And that's good. And then unit tests, yes, the unit tests we perform in the development. So you write the unit test, then the pre-flight test, that's right. And the infrastructure test, it depends. If it's the execution and then you want to execute it in your environment here, whether you have the testing environment, you have the staging environment, you have the production environment, you can execute it. But the test, of course, you have to write it in the development. And then if you can see the testing at the development environment, we have the contract API test, the system test or end-to-end test, the exploratory test, yeah, or UATs. Yes, this is sometimes you have to put it here, right, in the staging. Performance load test, right, usually you are not performing the performance test in development environment because you want to perform the performance test in the environment that much more similar like your production. Usually you perform it in the staging environment. In the performance test, the integration and infrastructure test you can. Yes, that's good. You can have more tests, of course. And then in the staging environment, you conduct the UAT, the user acceptance test. And why do we still need the user acceptance test? It's simply because some of industry, especially Indonesia, if you are in the financial industry, you still have to do it, the user acceptance test. And it also makes sense because the business is the one who decide the release of the function, right? And then the stress test, the performance load test, all here you perform in the staging environment, right? With the environment that has the capacity more or similar like the productions, and then you can simulate, right, the performance of your application, your services. You can conduct stress tests, performance, spike tests, longevity tests, right? The A/B testing, you can perform it now. Usually you are performing in the production, you are, because then you want to test the reactions of your customer. Let's say you open the new feature to only 5% of your customers, and then you want to see the reaction. Is it good on the new feature, or how's the traffic? So you are performing the A/B testing. The quality verification, you can have it in all of your environment. The static application security test, this is one of the fundamental of security tests that usually perform in the organization right now. The static application security test should be part of this one, right? The static application security test, right? If you are familiar with the tools like Sonar Cube, right? Sonar Cube, Sonar Cloud, or other tools, the static code analysis, you want to ensure that this is performed early in your delivery cycles, right? So when your team or your development team pushes their source code or commit the source code, it should perform the static application security test part of the early assessment. So they get early feedback, right? And then you see the dynamic application security test, we should perform it here in the staging environment. So dynamic application security test is the security, this is the security test, the black box test that will attack your running services after you deploy it automatically. After you deploy it automatically in your environment, it will run this black box test, just like an attacker trying to attack your system and then find for your vulnerability, right? This is the dynamic application security test. You don't want to perform it in production, of course, right? Okay. So this is the examples, just the example of how your test activity in the pipeline in your fast delivery cycles, right? So we'll see here, some of the tests are manual, but then we reduce the manual tests, the manual test execution gradually, and then most of the tests are automated, right? So the ensure fast delivery cycle with the quality here. Thank you. I will stop the timer here, and then let's go back to the presentation slide. So we have tried, right, to put all the test activity in our delivery cycles. I want to share you one example. This is the example of the pipeline. With the quality assessment in this process, start from your source code management, yes, the use of trunk-based development and the feature flag. You perform development, you linting your code, you test locally, you conduct peer review in your team, right? Start from the development early in the process. That's why they call it the shift left, right? You want to shift left, to push as early as possible. And then merge request and approval, right? It depends on your tools. If you are using GitLab, they call it merge request and approval, right? Will trigger the unit test, check for code coverage, and then it will also trigger the security test, right? Like the static application security test, like the software composition analysis there, right? And then we call it these activities before, let's say if you trigger the merge request, it will perform the automatic static application security test, scan for your source code, and then software composition analysis, scan for your library or vulnerability in your component. And then the approval will get the message that he or she has to review. And then the review will become easier because the result of the static application and software composition analysis and also the unit tests are there, so they can approve it easily. So they have the data, right? After that, it will trigger build and then back your service into the container image. And you want to perform automated container image scanning, of course. And then if all these processes are good, and then you are deploying into the environment, and then you perform the automated functional tests, you perform the performance test, right? And then the dynamic application security testing, you want to perform it. And then you promote the services, and then you can use some of the deployment strategy like the canary, perform the smoke test to ensure the functionality are working. The smoke test usually you perform it in the productions. And of course, health check, your monitoring, you should have your monitoring to health check. Also, you should have the monitoring for your pipeline itself, right? So not just the services, but the pipeline. If you implemented the pipeline, you should have the monitoring for your pipeline. This is how the delivery cycles looks like in the automated fashion way, which takes you around 10 minutes to from your code commit, right? Your code commit into the productions. If you skip all these manual trigger, it should take around 10 minutes. This is what should look like in your day-to-day API delivery, right? So you have all the quality assessments in the automated fashion way. You put the threshold, you put the quality criteria, so your team knows what should they improve, what should they do in order to deploy their changes, right, into the production. And then you ensure that all the governance are there also, and the quality are there, right? So this is the example of how you automate your API delivery with the quality. Okay, so we have the demo of CI/CD pipeline, right? So in the previous slide, we saw that the example of the test activity and all the activity in the CI/CD pipeline, but what it looks like in the real world. So we have prepared some demo, right? So the live demos. If you have any question, feel free, of course. So the demo, I will switch my screen to Thomas. So let Thomas share the screen and show the demo. Okay, let me stop the sharing. Thomas, feel free to.
Okay, Madi, I will share my screen.
Okay.
Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. I will start the session now. Hey everyone, as mentioned by Madi before, we can automate our API delivery with quality and speed through the DevOps CI/CD pipeline, from the development until the production, from the commit, from the developer commit until the deployment to production. And this is the demo. What we will cover in the demo, one is the CI/CD pipeline with quality and speed, also collaboration through the pipeline, release evidence, and then pipeline model for your API team. This one, the last one, we will show about the monorepo pipeline. Okay. Here is our working sample that we prepare for this demo. Actually, this is a Java Micronaut API backend. We use GitLab repository to version it, and we use GitLab CI as a DevOps automation tools. In this demo, we will show how we can automate continuous delivery CI/CD from development to production. It starts when a developer or development team push the code changes, and they request merge to the master branch through GitLab merge request. As you can see here, there is a new code changes from the development. He add one API, new API, and then he requests merge. Yeah, he requests merge. After that, the CI pipeline run. As Madi said before, there is a pre-flight test. Yeah, there is a pre-flight test triggered by the push request, the merge request. This is a unit test job. We can make sure all unit tests pass, and then container test, SASTI test, and SCA test. This is the security test. For the container test, we can make sure that we build Docker image and there is no vulnerability on that image. And static application security test, we can check quality code using tools like SonarQube. And the software composition analysis test, we can check the code dependencies, vulnerability using tools like Snyk. This pipeline is run on the enhanced API account patch by type branch, so that the developer can get early feedback whenever what of this job is getting failed. And this is and when this all is passed, we can also get notification through chat tools like Slack, like I show you here. Yes, this one I have request the merge request. And then the CI pipeline is passed. So I get the early feedback whenever the CI pipeline is passed on is failed. Okay, so whenever it failed, the developer, I am as a developer, I can quickly fix the code and repush it again to the source repository. And then CI pipeline will run again and verify and do the test and verify the code. Okay. And then after that, we can do the peer code in this merge request. If there is anything wrong with the code changes, we can do the review here, and then after that, if anything going right, we can merge it into the master branch. After merge into master branch, the pipeline CD pipeline will run. Yeah, this is the CD pipeline. We run the unit test, security test, and then we package it into the jar file, and then we do the pre-deployment dev. This is actually the updating database development whenever there is a change in the data structure, maybe or in the data, and then we deploy to the ACS, AWS ECS. And then we perform functional test API. We can use Catalon or Gmeter here. And then after we pass the test, we can trigger or manual trigger to the staging. It depends on the for each organization. Some organization need to make it manual. We can make it manual trigger to do the update DB for the staging environment and then deploy to the staging environment. And then we can do the dynamic application security test to check the API's vulnerability here. And also we can do some performance tests here. We can put from performance test here. And after all the tests is passed, we can tag the repository and also the registry docker. And then we can do the release for release candidate nodes. Yeah. We set it release candidate node. When we view it, I can show you the example. This is the release candidate node that we generate from our pipeline. We can see the evidence here, the report that we already passed. I can show you one example here about the testing. Yeah, this is the scanning report about the vulnerability that we already found in our API here. This is the report you can view one by one here. There is a page also about the SEA test, SASTIP test, and the other one, coverage test and dusty test. This is the page here. And also we can see here, there is a change log. This is new feature added. And also we can put here the develop staging deployment triggered by me. And then we go back to the CD pipeline. Okay. And then after that, we can manual trigger to the production. And then deploy to the production, same like the staging one, we use ECS. And then we can do the, after deployment to production, we can do some smoke test. We can use tools like Jmeter or Catalon to perform smoke test. And then after that, we can tag the repository and the Docker registry. Okay. That is the pipeline here that we, our example pipeline, CD pipeline. And then I will show you the code itself. This is the sample of GitLab CI pipeline code. There is a state, as you can see here, there is so many states. We can see here, this is the states, unit test, security test, package. We can define here, and I will show you one example of the deployment to ECS. This is the code of deployment. We can use the Docker image as a base image to run the job. And then this is the script. And we can specify the environment also. Nah, as you can see here, there is not easy to maintain the code as your pipeline become more complex. It will be so many line of codes. So for Microsoft application, there will be more than just a microservice application. It may be 10, 20 or more. It will be difficult to maintain all the automation code pipeline. We have to change all the code for each repository when the job is changed. Like I said before, maybe we need to change our tools, Dusty tools. We need to change one by one for each repository. And then in small team, one developer might be develop few microservices. He needs to open so many windows of his EDA to works and trigger push one by one for each repository. And also we need a good collaboration to run the pipeline. Maybe one and another repo has dependency is other. We have to kill it manually. Then I will show you one monorepo example. Actually, this is example microservice. We have three microservices here. We make it mono repository, one repo for all microservices, and then we make this one, we make template. We make template for the job. For example, for deploy CS, we make the template here and we use in each of the GitLab CI code in each microservice, for example here. I will show you the deployment. Now this one, to deploy the ECS production, we extend from template deployment ECS. So we doesn't need to script it again here. And also in the other microservice, we do the same. Yeah, we just extend it. Okay. And then for all the repository, there is no need for us to run it all together, but only the changes we can specify here when the code of data owner is changed, only the only the pipeline, only the job related to owner that will run. If there is a changes on the path microservice, only the job that related to the path microservice will run. For example, I will show you the pipeline, already run pipeline. This is the pipeline. I'm making a changes for the owner and path microservice, and then it run the unit test, integration test, security test, package deployment until the tech release to production. And as you can see here, there is a direct acrylic grab. You can see that each of microservice has their own related pipeline here. You see direct acrylic grab. Yeah. And using this using needs on this code, using needs, we can specify the dependency of the job also. So within the same pipeline, we can have its independent running pipeline for its microservice. Okay. That's all from me, Pak Mati.
Thank you, Dr. Thomas.
Thank you
for the demo. Okay. Let me back to share my screen. I think we still have times. I have to go faster, I think. Can you see my screen? Can you see my screen?
Yes, Pak Mari.
Yes, so in the demo, we have seen the fast delivery process with the quality assessment in the pipeline. So also the pipeline for our API development and operation. So we have several APIs, and then we can put in one repository. We can use mono repo and then only one pipeline for the API, right? And then what it looked like in the API ecosystem. So if we have the business capability API, so we should have the pipeline. We should have the pipeline, right? This is, you can store all the APIs in your domain in one repository using the mono repo approach, and then only one pipeline. And then if you have the API gateway, API management platform, you should have the pipeline also, so you can promote all the changes easily. This is the example of the CI/CD in API ecosystems. As I mentioned before, the hybrid skills. So this is the survey from the DevOps Institute 2020 upskilling report. The top one skill is the CI/CD toolchain skills. So it's the must-have skills in your team, right? And then if you put all the practices that we need, this is the Gartner DevOps model in 2015. In our demo that we show, all the CI/CD is only part of the skills that we have to build in our organizations, right? So this is the skills that we show in our session today, in our demo, that enable the continuous delivery capabilities, right? And then the other on the other side, not just the technical skills but also the human skills, right? So the must have human skills, if we only see the top one, is the collaboration and cooperation. So you should have the human skills also. You ensure your team, because they are interacting with the people, right? So the collaboration and cooperation is the must have skills in your team also. So we expect the team become a T-shaped profile, at least. So if your team only good at one thing, it means he or she is specialist. And then if we collaborate in the team, help others, and then learns, they become a T-shaped profiles. So they have the broad knowledge, the broad knowledge here, and also the deep expertise on one field. and then you want to grow them into the E-shape, the competency model. This is the competency model in the modern IT enterprise that we want, right? So to modernize your IPA development operation, we have to start from putting rock solid foundation and knowledge, bring everybody on the same page with training workshop of gamifications, right? So the T-shape team, we want to form the T-shape team here. So start with the knowledge. The DevOps Institute, we have several courses, start from the DevOps foundation, continuous testing to DevOps leader. So if I use the analogy of the, if we are in the same boat, of course, we are in the same organization, they say, you want to put the rock solid foundation in your team. So it means start from the DevOps foundation or the SRE foundations for your ops and infra team, and then to improve the quality, continue with the higher courses like continuous testing foundation, and of course, don't forget your leader. They have to lead the transformations, right? So they have to know how to become a transformational leaders, right? To support and give the sponsorship of course, and how to inspire the team and lead the transformations. So this is the example of the subject in the DevOps Foundation. You will learn the principle, the technical practice, the automation, how to measure your DevOps, and then how it works with the Agile and other practices as well, right? So don't stop there. And then after the training, you have to implement the knowledge, right? In order to get 100% impact. So if you are just, let's say, send your people to the training class, they will get 30% maximum impact. And then after that, they have to continue to implement the knowledge, right? But you cannot directly jump to this one. You have to put the rock solid foundations to them, right? Start with the training and then let them experiment, right? So in summary, start from the knowledge, bring everybody on the same page with the training, workshop, or gamification, and then piloting. Enable them in implementations, right? You might want to bring some experts, of course, mentoring and coaching to accelerate the transformation journey, and let DevOps be part of your processes, become a modern API development and operations, right? Yeah. So API is great, DevOps is great, but they are great together, they are better together, right? So like this one. I want to also, before I close the session, I want to show you some interesting facts. This is from Gartner prediction in December 2019. They said the Agile and DevOps are key to digital transformation. So Agile and DevOps will be the de facto approach to develop and deploy services to enable the continuous delivery. So there will be no separation between Agile and DevOps anymore in the future. So, and they will become the de facto standard. If you are not starting yet with this, all these practices, and then develop your team into the T-shape profile, you have to start with putting the rock solid foundation, the training, and then workshop, and then start implementing and piloting, right? Thank you for joining the session. You can visit our website, naradacode.com. You can see all the training here, or the simulation, our services, the consulting services, and also how we guide the implementation. Some insights are there, and some events are there. Thank you, and let's keep connected. We have our LinkedIn, me and also Thomas. So feel free to connect with us, and then we can have discussions after, of course, after this workshop, right? Thank you, everyone. I think we are run out of the time, so let's give the time to the upcoming workshop. Thank you, everyone, for joining the workshop. Our workshop. Thank you.
Thank you, man. Bye bye.
Bye bye.